Welcome to this video on aliasing and the Nyquist theorem. To start, we'll explain aliasing through an interesting example. Why do car wheels in movies sometimes appear to spin backward? Then, we'll explore how this phenomenon applies to digital signals and its impact on sampled data. Finally, we'll introduce a MATLAB simulation, allowing you to experiment with aliasing and the Nyquist theorem yourself. Now, let's dive into the mystery behind the backward rotating wheels. On the left, we have a wheel spinning continuously. To represent this motion digitally, we take samples by capturing images every 90 degrees. As you can see, even though the motion isn't as smooth as the continuous rotation, we can still easily tell which direction the wheel is turning. Now, let's reduce the sampling rate by taking images every 180 degrees. As you can see, the motion becomes even more choppy, and it's harder to tell the direction the wheel is rotating. The less frequent sampling makes it difficult for our brain to track the wheel's movement accurately. In the final example, we take snapshots every 270 degrees. And here's where things get interesting. Although the wheel is rotating forward, the sampled images make it appear as though the wheel is spinning backward. This happens because our brain assumes the shortest path between the snapshots, 90 degrees backward, rather than the expected 270 degrees forward. This is the aliasing effect in action. And this brings us to the Nyquist theorem. After seeing this example, it's easy to understand that if we capture at least two snapshots of the wheel's 180 degree rotation, essentially covering half the wheel, we could clearly determine the direction of rotation. This is exactly what the Nyquist theorem tells us. It states that to accurately reconstruct a continuous analog signal from its sampled version, the sampling rate must be at least twice the highest frequency present in the signal. If this concept still seems a bit abstract, let's examine it in the context of digital signal sampling. Imagine we have a continuous analog sine wave with a frequency of 2 Hz. To represent it digitally, we take 8 samples per second. Now, given just these samples, can we determine the exact sine wave that created the original signal? At first, it seems like we can. We can draw a 2 Hz sine wave through these points. But if we look closer, we realize that a 10 Hz sine wave would also fit. So would an 18 Hz wave, and infinitely many others. This means that from the samples alone, we cannot uniquely identify the original signal. The key assumption we make is that the original signal must be the one with the lowest possible frequency that fits the samples. This allows us to reconstruct it correctly. Now let's take another example. Suppose the original signal has a frequency of 9 Hz and we sample it at 8 Hz. When we attempt to reconstruct it, the lowest possible frequency that fits these samples is 1 Hz, not 9 Hz. This is aliasing. Even though the actual signal was 9 Hz, after sampling, it appears as a 1 Hz sine wave instead. According to the Nyquist theorem, when sampling at 8 Hz, we can only accurately represent frequencies up to 4 Hz. Any frequencies beyond this threshold will be misinterpreted as lower frequencies within the 0 to 4 Hz range. They're aliases. And that wraps up the second part of our presentation. Now, let's bring these concepts to life with a MATLAB simulation. You can also download the code using the link in the description. We begin by clearing the workspace and closing any open plots. Next, we define the simulation parameters. First, we set the frequency of the sine wave we want to generate. Then, we define the pseudo-analog sampling frequency, which determines how finely we represent the continuous signal. We set it to 100 kHz, assuming it's high enough to treat the signal as continuous. Lastly, we set the actual sampling frequency to 10 Hz, which is too low to properly capture a 9 Hz signal. This will allow us to observe the aliasing effect in action. Now, let's generate the pseudo-analog sine wave. We start by creating 1 second of time samples, then generate the signal using the sin function and the previously defined frequency. Finally, we plot the signal. As you can see, the 9 Hz continuous sine wave is now displayed. Now, let's take discrete samples from the continuous signal. We create a time vector by selecting every few points to match the 10 Hz sampling rate. Then, we compute the corresponding values and add them to the plot. As you can see, 10 points now appear on the graph, representing the digitized version of the signal. Next, let's compute the spectrum of the analog signal using MATLAB's FFT function. If you're unfamiliar with how it works, check out our video on the discrete Fourier transform for a deeper explanation. We also calculate the frequency indices and plot the spectrum. As you can see, the graph shows a clear peak at 9 Hz, which corresponds to the signal frequency. Now, let's reconstruct the signal. First, we apply linear interpolation, which connects the sampled points with straight lines. We use MATLAB's interpolate function, where the first two arguments are the time and signal samples, the third specifies the desired time points, and the last defines the interpolation method. If you're curious about interpolation techniques, we'll cover them in a separate video. Next, we compute the spectrum of the reconstructed signal and generate a plot to illustrate the entire process. As you can see in the right-hand plot, the reconstructed wave has a frequency of 1 Hz, not the original 9 Hz. This discrepancy is due to the aliasing effect. And that's it for this video. If you want to keep exploring DSP fundamentals, check out our next video on the correlation function. Thanks for watching.